ordinary because I didn't pass my GCSE and 6. I didn't. I wasn't given the opportunity. I don't know whether I would have passed or failed because my teachers thought I couldn't have passed. I have to wait until I'm 15. And I was one of the best in my set to write at 15 because normal people would write it at 16. So that still remains a phenomenon. Look at this is still the meek tooth. With the meek tooth, you're supposed to be at player group and playing school. So you have no right to even spell your name, let alone write a candidate number or have a UCI number. It's a profound movement in terms of human understanding. And then comes Samantha, who literally passed a double mathematics. You know, normally, normal 16-year-olds pass maths. The top in the group do double maths, further maths, advanced maths, additional maths. And at the end of 6, passed double mathematics. And then gets a scholarship to 12 schools. So again, you can say that's a phenomenon. What we've not understood up to now is what learning is and how dynamic learning is. What we've not understood is really sit down and have a look at this and say, what do we call genius? What are we talking about when you say genius? When you say a child is a genius or a human being is a genius, what essentially do we mean? How do we define it? We haven't included a few things because we focus on this. Say, it's based on your natural talent. Your father has green, black hair, you have black hair. Okay? Your mother has brown eyes, you have brown eyes. So your mother can sing, you can sing. Or your brother can dance, you can dance. We just say natural talent is inherited. And if it's inherited, there's nothing anybody can do about it. My father was bad at maths, I'm bad at maths, we're bad at maths in my family. So there's no point for me to even try to see how I can improve my mathematical ability because this is our stereotype, this is dominant thinking in education right now. But what we have excluded is the fact that we have tools that are emerging. What we've excluded is the fact that we have technology. What we've excluded is the fact that we have techniques that are changing. Now, if you bring all these three factors into it, it alters your genius and reduces your so-called innate ability. Because some of us know of at least two or three people that were childhood friends that are visually handicapped. That means they can't see. Yes? And some of us would have also known of those ones that went on to graduate from university in spite of the fact they can't see. Blind friends. We had that one in the United Kingdom. His name is David Blunkett. He was the education minister. If he speaks, you'll be in trouble. He understands education more than me, that has two eyes. When he's going to parliament, he goes with a dog, Lucy. I want you to Google it and find out. But he managed to understand his technique for learning. He knows that he cannot see. And because he cannot see, he does not use visual aids. He uses auditory and uses braille. So he's refined his feeling and he's refined his hearing. So if he hears anything from you, he stores it in his long-term memory, locks it up in long-term memory. So if you went to parliament and say because he's blind, you want to make comments to him, you'll be in trouble. Because he's one of the fiercest debaters I've ever seen on the planet Earth. So you will say he's a genius. But the point is that he's managed to get that angle right, and that angle boosts every aspect of his learning. And all of us have this. That's one thing the study we've done in excess has shown that all of us have a dominant learning technique. Some of us are very, very visual. So if you see anything, you will never forget it again. Some of us are like that, programmed that way. Okay. Others are auditory. So if they hear a story, they will never forget. Others are kinesthetic. If they do something, they will never, ever forget it. Others are blended. And the policy we're suggesting to the government now is at least pilot this. When children start secondary school, put them into different classes on the basis of their learning techniques, not on their date of birth or their father's surname. I've never worked that out. Isn't that idiotic? In 2013, we get boys and girls to start secondary school and we put them in the classes on the basis of their father's alphabet's name. I don't understand that. Why can't we look for something that is more related to learning and say, because all of you are left-handed, work together, right-handed work together, or because you're visual, work together. Why must we classify students randomly? What are we trying to prove? Then other times we put it on the basis of ability. What is ability is a nebulous term that tells me somebody that did the exam better than the other. It doesn't tell me that this person is more knowledgeable than the other. So this is a thing that we've ignored. And then technology is coming to it. The beauty of technology is the fact that we now have more technological power in the classroom than we ever had in a generation. If I was taking a class today, almost every other person has either an iPhone, an iPad, or HTC of some sort. And that could not have happened 20 years ago. So the person that was visual could not record the class. So now the person can record my slides on video, and when he gets home, he plays it, and he plays it, and he plays it. And because it's visual, he would never forget it. It's just a basic thing that any human being can do, because technology has changed. Why must you write pen and paper when my great-grandparents used exactly that? And it took them about 3 weeks, if they were very fast, to move from London to New York. Most time, it took them 4 weeks to move from London to New York. That was the technology available to them. Nobody could fly. Now, it takes all of us here, no matter how slow we are, a maximum of 5 hours to make that same journey that took them, how many weeks? 4 to 3 weeks. Do we understand what we're saying? Why can't we bring that technology to the classroom and accelerate learning and see what difference it makes? That's essentially what I'm advocating, what we advocated by this. And then we were able to generate, the Excellence in Education program does that to every student that comes in. If you're a student before you start the program, you are assessed for your learning preference. If you don't know your learning preference, you will not be given your table, because your table is based on how many people are here, all of them are visual. How many people are there, all of them are kinesthetic, they do things and they remember. How many people are there, all of them are auditory, so they hear things and they remember. And because they work in such little groups, it doubles their productivity without doing anything. You don't change the teacher, you use the same teacher, you teach the same subject, you spend the same hours, but you just use a different subgroup. They bond because they are like a family, and this is like a family, and the way they interact is different. So in classes, it'd be useful if you're able to replicate that or scale that up and establish what use that is. Because of that, we've then gone to replicate that same result we saw with the twins in non-biologically related people. I mean, not cousins, not even the same background. And the few case studies I'm going to show, that some of you may have seen, Fabrice Muamba. He's a footballer, plays football for England, and play for Arsenal, sorry, if you don't support Arsenal. And 18 months ago, he was playing football and he fainted. And then he died. I don't know whether, did you see the story he was a product of this program. Fabrice Muamba, before then, had 10 GCSEs as a footballer, right? He was playing for the junior English team, was playing football for the team. He wrote his GCSE mathematics as a year 9 student, and it is still on record in his school as the youngest person ever to write GCSE at that age. But that's in spite of playing football for England and playing for junior Arsenal. And then went on to get his A-levels. It's very rare for a footballer to have the discipline to do A-level. But because of his so-called new innate ability, I don't believe it's new, I don't believe it's innate, I believe the technique is more important than your ability, your so-called biological ability. So you've got a whole multitude of previous things that have been on it. So that's the story about Fabrice. Again, you can take his name, Google it, and see what the media says about him. But when he started the program, what informed me in life that I feel on the day I graduated from university, you know, when you finish from university, you wear a gown, you wear a cap, you get your parents, you get your friends, you take photographs, and you're very happy that you graduated, thinking that you know anything. I knew, after working with Fabrice, that I absolutely knew nothing. I wonder why they gave me a gown, and why they took photographs of me, and why they gave me new letters. Because when Fabrice came to us, he was told that he was in the bottom set. That means the bottom group in maths. And the reason he was brought was because the mother brought him and said, "That's Fabrice. He's very, very playful. All he does is football. He's not serious with his work." And because of the stories that they've heard about us, I said, "Okay, yes, Fabrice, you're very bad at maths." He said, "Yes, I'm very bad at maths. Very, very bad at maths. You know, I said, okay, what about football? Oh, very good at football. Okay. I play football. Amateur football. I know you cannot be good at football and bad at maths. I know that. So, okay, how many times have you been man of the match? Look at the question I'm asking him. I'm asking to calculate. Then he went, and then he told me. Oh. Okay. How many times have you scored? He told me. Okay. What's your favorite football team? He told me, Arsenal. Okay. They are playing a match on Saturday. Say yes. If they win, what position would they be on the league table? And then he told me. If they lose, what position would they be? He told me. If they draw, what position would they be? He told me. Do you know what I was telling him to do? That's the most difficult mathematical computation any human being can do. Yeah, he's telling me he's in the bottom set in the school. I said, are you sure you're in the bottom set? Of course I'm in the bottom set. I'm in the bottom set. Okay? And then, who is your favorite player? He said, Patrick Vieira. Why is he your favorite player? He told me his number. Every question I now asked him was not mathematical. But he didn't know. He thought it was football. So do you understand the way the human mind works? Okay, at the end of it, and the mother was getting very exasperated. I brought him here to learn maths. This man is telling him football. If I wanted football, I shouldn't bring him to him to talk about football. But I wanted to identify his interests. Because once I know your interests, I can always get to your learning. I've seen students before that hate algebra. But when you get a Bart Simpson voiceover on algebra, they listen to it. It's not because they like algebra, but they like Bart Simpson. So I said, okay. I then brought a paper for him, a foundation paper. I said, okay, write this. He wrote the foundation. I said, yeah, this is a low paper for me. Then I got the higher paper for him. So I thought you're my friend. This paper is too hard. I can't do this. I said, but how did you know? He said, the teacher told me. Teachers taught me before. They know this is too hard for me. I went to the photocopying room. I photocopied the cover page foundation, but the questions were hard. And gave it to him. I said, yes. Yes. And he sat down and he worked through the questions. All the questions. And I kept it. And I gave him now the next year's one. I photocopied the cover to the foundation that he likes. And I gave him the harder paper and he worked through. And I marked it. And I found out that he got 75% of the questions right. So it was his belief and his thinking. Then when I came back, I gave him the higher paper to do this time. He said, no, I told you we can't do this. Then I said, wait for 1 minute. I opened the paper and I showed him the question and he saw that there was no difference. That's essentially his turning point in knowing that he's more mathematical than the traditional assessment told him he was. And some of us here did not read literature because they told us we're bad at literature. That you're good at numbers, so go and do numbers. What they didn't tell you is that if you were a football supporter and they gave you a book written on David Beckham, whether you like literature or you don't like literature, you will read a book on David Beckham because on the back of your door in your house is David Beckham. If you like Formula One and Lewis Hamilton, right? You like Lewis Hamilton, you put it at the back of your door, you hate reading. But if I give you a book on Lewis Hamilton, you will read it. But if I give you a book on Shakespeare, you hide it under the table. But it's a paragraph you see in Lewis Hamilton that you see in Shakespeare, right? Yes. It's a punctuation you see. So if we decide to be creative in the way we deliver our content, it alters the student's thinking of that subject. And that's why he ended up successful. Right now he's a doctor. That just understood that he got his doctorate recently. So that's one case study I probably want to see. Akram is very similar. Can you see what he's holding? Football. We have to look at the circumference of the football. We have to measure the football. We have to look at the pitch of the football. We have to calculate the football. So we did the mathematics of football, and he enjoyed it. But when he goes to the classroom, they say, no, you're bottom of the set. So are we teaching maths, or are we teaching curriculum-based maths? That's essentially what I feel so bad that I just discovered I could have spoken 15 languages when I was 16. But my French teacher and I did not get on. So I thought because I didn't like her, I didn't like French, and French is her. When really, French is nothing to do with her. If you've ever been to Quebec, you know why French is French. Because you now know that your teacher deprived you of the opportunity to be able to be bilingual and communicate with North Americans in such a way that you can win a whole crowd to yourself. So I hope we I'll probably see a few more, few other. Ali, Jude Ali, not related to the twins, not related to other cases, is from Peckham, one of the least performing area in London, and we started the same project there. Rolled out exactly the same project. What is annoying is that we're getting exactly the same result. So it's not the students, it's not the innate ability, it's more of the methodology. Because what doesn't surprise me is that if all of us here go to Heathrow and enter the plane at the same time, we'll get to New York at exactly the same time. Because the methodology of traveling is exactly the same. So if you are Usain Bolt, that's the fastest man on the planet, or you're the slowest grandmother, it doesn't matter. If you get on the same plane, you get to the other side at the same time. So what we're literally developing using informatics is a plane that takes everybody there at exactly the same time. Again, this is another one that is not related. You can pick up her story on the BBC. Another 6-year-old from inner city London, deprived area in Dagenham, Barking at Dagenham, getting a GCSE of almost preschool and still being able to be normal, play music, get involved in sports, do everything. It's not because they've spent additional time studying the subject, it's just because they studied it differently from the way I was forced to study it. A black and white book, a teacher in front of me, and probably punishment. You know, say, if you don't do it, you're in trouble. If you do it, you're in. So I was given a totally different paradigm from the way these ones have been asked to do it. And Paula's interview really says it. Okay, where do they go to? That's D. Ali at the age of 5. Passed her Oxford Cambridge exam in mathematics, set for 16-year-old. And the same year was painful. That same year, when her result was published, other people's results were published, and we had in England alone 300,000 boys and girls that were 16-year-olds that failed the exam. Same exam. And those 300,000 think that they are stupid and think that she's a genius. That's what worries me. And therefore give up on science, when really science is going to come back and haunt all of us. In another 2 years, our use of technology is even going to, according to the Boston Institute, is still going to double. So we have been over technologized. So you cannot hide away from it. So that's another one. That's Amory mentored her. That's the word that they're using, a mentor, yes? We're borrowing that from the Chinese. Mentored her and Amory got invited by Oxford at the age of 13 to come and start a degree program on a government scholarship. Where do they go to? At the age of 14, the banks bid for them. Where do they go to? They're still normal people, just doing things different. And that's Sarah from Ilford. That's a confirmed case study as well. Passing the same set of paper and working through the same exam. So all of you might say, oh, why are we all talking about one subject? Okay, the remarkable twins picked up their A-level results. That's Wincy picked up his. And you might say, oh, everybody's doing maths. No, not maths. The girl, the black girl there, I want to emphasize the fact that she's black. And I want to say it again that she's black. She's black because both parents are black. All grandparents are black. And all grandparents are black. 3 generations black. Now, she said her interest was in German. Remember, all the case studies we've been doing so far has been mathematical. And she was interested in doing it. I said, okay, if that's what you want to do, let's see what we're going to do. And then went on and did Google DE. You know, if you go google.de, it gives you all Germanic content. And then we interacted with that. We got some videos in German. She watched them, got some more clips in German. She looked at them. And she was in Hackney. Hackney is the lowest performing borough in the United Kingdom. The lowest performing borough. Her school was one of the lowest performing. In her school, when you write German in year 11, that means the final year of secondary school, only 36% pass. And now she's year 9 telling the teacher she wants to write German. They say, you used to be a good girl, you're smoking something strong now. How can you write German when it's the most difficult subject in the school? It's a foreign language. Your father is not German, your mother is not German, you're not half German. You're not quarter German, and you just have to say, oh, yes, I like it. And we've heard, they've done it, math, I'm going to do it. And don't tell children stories, because they'll come back and take you up on it. Okay? She did the German. I was hoping that she gets a C. just a C grade, because the German teacher in school told her, listen, you will fail. And told her, and wrote it in a letter and sent it to your parents, said, if you write drama before your time, you will fail, and you get disinterested in the subject, and you get disgruntled, and you won't do anybody any good. And she said, oh, that's fine, I'll still do it anyway. And reluctantly, the school put her in to write the German exam. And I was hoping she gets a C. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Chimemela. She did not get a C. She did not get a B. She did not get an A. She got an A star. Remember, she's not covered the syllabus, the curriculum. She's only just watched videos and read stories online. How was she able to get more than people that were more than 2 years her seniors? It triggered my memory. I was wondering over that. And then 2 weeks later, they got a letter from AQA saying that of all the scripts in the country, she scored the highest marks. Remember, she's not German. The people that wrote that exam, some were half German. That means father German, mother English. Or mother English, father, do you understand what I'm saying? There were mixed race students that wrote the exam. Okay. So how did she learn German? When she's not German, she doesn't live in German, there's no German connection, there's no genetic component. What I'm trying to say, the first photograph I showed you, the graph I showed you had a red part called natural talent. She doesn't have it in her gene. She didn't inherit it from anybody. And she got a scholarship, of course, she got a series of scholarships on the basis of that, because she's now classified as gifted. You know what they say? They say she's super gifted, she's linguistically gifted. And the next year, she picked up French. Now, she's had confidence. Her cousin, she was ahead, the present she got when she passed, her cousin said, can I also do French? I like French. And she, her cousin did French, she did French. Guess what? They scored the highest marks in the country. So I worked out a formula then. Anything that happens once is a coincidence. Anything that happens once, an accident, twice is a coincidence. If you now replicate it, it's no longer a phenomenon. It's based on fundamental principles. So we now went back and retraced what steps did we take in Chimemela, and we found out that the biggest textbook on the planet for anybody that wants to learn German is www.google.de. That's the biggest book, not the books in the library. If we want to do it as an accelerated, it is the biggest book. So the internet remains the biggest book. Ivan is a slightly different one, and he did some in ICT, because he likes computers, he likes games, he likes things. So he did his ICT in primary school, at primary school age. And that opened up my thinking and completely challenged whatever they've told me in school. And since then, it's not just become a routine, it's almost a factory, it's a mill. It's like Ford Motors, you know, Ford puts in this, it's not literally a mill. And you don't have to have wealth, because in this country, we classify people on the basis of socioeconomic background. So you don't have to be from a wealthy area. You don't have to be from a poor area, because we've done it in two extremes. You don't have to be tall. You don't have to be short. You don't have to be... It's not your physical size. It's not your parenting. It just has to do with which principles are you following and how are you applying informatics to it. That's another girl from back in the dark now. And I can bore you with more examples of students that have done it. And the teacher training institute is now trying to engage us and see how we can explain these principles. It's not a big deal, it's just a simple formula. Explain these principles to teachers that are working in hard to reach schools, so-called hard to reach school. The reason I'm not happy with that is that every teacher should have it. Every single person that was a captain of a ship, if you wanted to fly a plane, you had to learn to be a pilot, yes? I believe all our teachers, all of us in this room, my generation and your generation, were misled into thinking about our current abilities and our current potential. I believe that. And I don't hold it against them. I know that the research available to them was totally different from the research available to me. And I, therefore, would not disagree with TDA, wanted to do things. A few institutions, the Times Education Supplement 2 has done some work on what we've done and potential validity. Cambridge is quite keen on the Enrich program so that children can still stay at home and be able to interact with advanced concepts in maths and enjoy it, because they see it as a game. What I'm saying, in the number game, is that they do. And because they see it as a game, they don't see it as a chore. And psychologists will tell you, the American psychologist Otto Habermann said this, if you see something as a hobby, you spend more time with it. So when we classify our boys and girls, I say, if you are 7 years old, your attention span is 20 minutes, and so your class should not exceed 20 minutes. And if you are 8 years old, your attention span is 25 minutes, is wrong. Because on Saturday morning, give them a remote control. So they decide what channel, and tell me what the attention span is. Hours. So it's attention span is task-related, not age-related. Because if you see them watching games, they watch the game for as long as they want to. So you can see why our entire educational foundation has been shaken by development and new technology. And until we rebuild it, we'll walk in the dark, just like our generation walked in the dark. We're doing some work with St. Cass, Cambridge. If you follow me on Twitter, you will have seen that now, because there's a program coming up in July on essentially looking at leadership, educational leadership, and sharing of that with Cambridge. Oxford has done some work as well, Keyboard's done some work, and Satoy is doing some fantastic work. Even forget everything I said today, please, can you go to manga, as in mangahigh.com, and see why you will hate your math teacher for the next 100 years, but don't. If you promise you won't hate them, I'll give you Manga High. Manga High gives you mathematical games and puzzle, and you will do it and do it and do it and do it. You will not even know you're doing maths, because it teaches you the principles of addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. And I'll conclude by saying this, that the work that has been done by Texas Instrument on human brain even makes me feel that I've not done what I need to do with these ones. They took one human brain. When we are born, when all of us came out of our mother's bed canal, we all have one brain. We had two hands, two eyes, normal legs. Each brain has 1 million cells or neurons. Texas Instrument took one human neuron, one cell, and raced it against a Texas calculator, electronic calculator, and wanted to find out one brain and one calculator which would act quicker. The human brain was quicker, better. Subtract quicker, the human brain. Multiply the human brain, divide the human brain. Then they now got 10 calculators and raised against one human cell, and the human cell still won. Now, they now network computers and raised against one human brain. Guess who won? One human brain. Now, the entire NASA computers, and NASA has supercomputers because they're sending men to moon and bring them back, was raised against one neuron, one human neuron. Guess who is more powerful? The human neuron. What we are finding out, the human neuron is great at processing information, but bad at storing information, except their memory. If every teacher knew that before they started teaching all of us, life would be different. So you can see why I honestly believe with Einstein that every single human being, the most disabled human being on the planet, is a genius. The most disabled, not on a fully formed. Because if you have 1 million cells and one cell can take care of NASA, then what are we saying? A 16-year-old cannot add, subtract, or divide? It's an insult on whoever made that cell. If every single car can drive on the road, and every single plane that Boeing makes flies, then please do not insult me by saying that somehow myself, my cousin, my niece, my nephew, I don't care who you are, we have one common humanity, is incapable of passing a GCSE at any age they want to. So I thank you for your attention. I'm prepared to take questions.